Good morning, one and all. This is Zahir Al. Good morning, one and all. This is Zahir Alam Khan again. I welcome you all on board of the last and fifth day of our FTP program, which is organized by Civil Engineering Department, Gates Institute of Technology. Firstly, I would like to thank all the participants for the time and patience to participate in this wonderful event and for giving wonderful feedbacks and responses. So not wasting much of your time, I would like to tell that today also we have a wonderful topic, that is full span launching of precast pre-stressed segments for railway bridges. To deliver out this presentation, we have our eminent speaker and resource person, Sri Kovendan Garu, who is a principal bridge engineer working with MMSB Consultants, Malaysia. So before I hand over this session to Mr. Kovendan, I would like to brief a little about his experiences and career. Kovendan sir has finished his engineering from Adi Parashakti Engineering College in 2005, and later he did his master's in structures from VIT in 2012. He has a total of 13 years of professional experience, in which 8 years he was a chartered structural engineer in designing of bridges for infrastructure projects in the core of analysis, design of RCC, PSC and steel bridge structures, along with 5 years of civil engineering experience in quantity surveying, execution, cost analysis, planning, monitoring and execution. So now I take the honor to welcome our resource person, Mr. Kovendan, to take over the session and enlighten us with his presentation. Over to you, sir. Thank you.
Good morning to everyone. I hope I am audible to everyone. Am I audible? Okay. I hope I am audible to everyone. Good morning.
You're audible, sir. Please continue, sir.
Yes, thank you. Very good morning to one and all. It's my pleasure to be a part of this 5-day FTP program on emerging trends in civil engineering. Particularly at this COVID situation, we are utilizing the virtual platform. I'm thankful to the correspondent and management for giving me the opportunity, and I'm thankful to the organizers and dear colleagues for giving me this opportunity. And last but not least, I'm thankful to the audience for utilizing this virtual platform at this situation for sharing and getting the information through this virtual platform. Today's my topic is on full span launching of precast pre-stressed segment for railway bridges. I hope my screen is visible to everyone. So I will directly go to the presentation. Today's content of Content of my topic and for discussion is introduction about latest trends and developments in railway segment. And before going for the exact topic of full span launching, I will give the brief idea about the classification of railway bridges, which will give some more idea what are the various kinds of bridges in railway terms. Then the particular case study of viaduct details, that is the bridge where we implemented this full span launching technology in the current construction scenario. Then the background of design philosophy, what is the design philosophy we used to follow in designing the railway structures. Then design standards, I just included this slide since it is a FTP program. I am giving the interpretation of academic codes, what we used to refer during our academic studies, and what when it comes for application orientation, when in the field, exact engineering field, what are the codes to be interpreted for different structures. So for better understanding of academic code reference and application code reference, I have made this slide. Then the details of viaduct full span launching method, where we have implemented this technology, and I have taken this as a case study for today's discussion. Then the other international projects where they are implementing these kind of developed technologies. I will go to my next slide. Introduction about the railway project, current railway project where we have implemented these technologies, dedicated freight corridor. I hope if we turn back newspapers for the last 2 years or 3 years, there are a few news about there is a current development in railway segment, that few of them they are going to offload as a privatization for the major development in railway infrastructures. So dedicated freight corridor is one of the major infrastructure projects which in current implementation in India. Let me brief about this dedicated freight corridor. It is, in short term, we used to call it as DFC. DFC planned across the country to mark a strategic inflection point in the history of Indian railways that has essentially run mixed traffic across its network. If you see the current scenario of our railway network, we are having a mixed traffic, that is passenger trains and cargo trains, which runs in a time frequency basis in the same railway network. To avoid this and to make only cargo transportation as more effective and passenger transportation as more effective, almost 10 years back, government has planned to implement this dedicated freight corridor as a major development in the Indian railway sector. Almost after 50 years, I believe it is after 50 years, we are having this kind of major railway project development. Then DFCC are proposed to adopt world-class and state-of-the-art technology with significantly higher design features that will enable it to withstand heavier loads, that is 32.5 ton axle load at a higher speed of 100 kmph. If you see our current railway network and cargo running capacity is maximum about 25 tons of axle load with a maximum speed of 80 kmph. So this has been considered and developed in the current railway project with a higher capacity, which is in the world-class technology. In other countries, they are using this. Same, we are also adapting in our scenario. This dedicated freight corridor, initially, central government has planned to implement in two corridors. That is Eastern Corridor and the other one is Western Corridor. Eastern Corridor starts from Ludhiana and then ends at this part, Dangoni in West Bengal. And the western part, it starts from Dadri in Haryana, and then it will end at JNPT in Maharashtra, that is Mumbai port. If you see the demographical corridor connecting point, it's nothing but they are connecting port to the industrial area. The basic idea of these corridors is they have to transport the imported raw material to and distribute to the industries and collect the finished products and export through ports. So major cargo transportation will be in these corridors. So they have planned to implement these world-class projects in these two corridors. And if you, there is separate website also they have created for dedicated freight corridor. It is a part comes under Indian Railway Ministry as a separate entity or separate body. So they are implementing this project, and mostly around 40 to 50% of the project construction stage was almost all over, and a trial run also they have made it. The part where we have worked in this dedicated freight corridor is WDFC, that covers a distance of 1,504 kilometers of double line electric, that is 2x25 kV electrical track from Mumbai JNPT to Dadri in Haryana. It runs via Vadodara, Ahmedabad, through Palanpur, Pulera and Rewari. It's a major part in Gujarat, that is Vadodara, Ahmedabad up to Palanpur. From Palanpur, it will travel in Rajasthan through Pulera and Rewari, Ajmer, and then it connects at Rewari in Haryana. It will end up with Dadri in Haryana. From Dadri, it is having a link to connect to the Eastern Corridor to make a further cargo transportation if required. In this Western Corridor, it has been planned in two phases. First phase will be in Rajasthan and Gujarat. Second phase, it is at Haryana and in Maharashtra. So the case study, what I have taken, the bridge name called Viaduct, it is in the part of phase two, that is from Dadri to Rewari. Usually the corridor terminology, they used it, name it as a package 14. So this package 14 covers around 140 kilometers. In that 140 kilometers, there are many bridges, around 382 bridges are there. In the 382 bridges, one of the major bridge which is having a longer length is Viaduct 92. It is around 2.76 kilometers that starts from Raipur to Rampur. So here we have adapted this full span launching technology in our execution. Basically, this project where I have been involved in this project and worked in this project is linked with L&T Construction. L&T Construction has involved in this project construction. The next slide is about the brief idea of classification of railway bridges. We know there are bridges. Generally, in academic point of view, if you see, people, they used to term it as bridges only, and then they used to call it as culverts. So when it comes to exact application, we have to go in detail about the bridge classification. Then only we will come to know what is the necessity and importance of the structure. So railway bridges are classified in two categories, that is culverts and box type small structures, and then span type structures. So mostly these culvert structures are box culverts, minor bridge, where the waterway, it is basically classified based on the waterway width and capacity of waterway, that is discharge of waterway. So minor bridges are classified like a box culvert, where the waterway is lesser than 1,000 square meters, and the vent size, it will be lesser than 10 meters. Then REB minor, this is not a waterway structure. If you see in a populated area, to avoid road crossing over the railway track, we are making culverts like our subways, that they term it as REB minor. Then pedestrian subways, where only pedestrians they used to cross it. Basically in station locations, we used to propose these kind of subways. Then pipe culverts, wherever minor waterway crossings are there we used to propose with the pipe culverts. So these are the minor structures. The major structures are classified in four categories. First is called a viaduct, which is having a longer length and more number of spans, which is more than single span will be more than 15 meter, and number of spans it will be more than 10 or 20. Basically the length of the bridge, it will be more than a kilometer. These kind of structures basically we used to adapt in terms of valleys, in terms of thickly populated areas where we cannot use the land for more than a kilometer. Then the important bridge, these important bridge classification is based on capacity of waterway and length of waterway crossing. So these important bridges, basically it will have waterway crossing of more than 1000 cubic and water span will be, single span itself, it will be more than 15 meter. Major bridges in between this important bridge and minor bridge, these are classified as major bridge. Then ROB, RFO, FOB, these are structures where we need to provide a platform for other mode of transportation to cross over our railway crossing. Since it is a dedicated freight corridor from the starting terminal to ending terminal, none of the crossings will cross like a level crossing. Every crossing will have its own structure to cross the railway track. That's why we used to call it as a dedicated freight corridor. ROB is termed as road over bridge. So basically our railway structure will be at the bottom, then road structure will cross it like a flyover. Rail flyover is nothing but bottom also will be a railway track, top also it will be a railway track. So wherever these connecting points are coming, if you see in Vadodara, there are major railway station is there. So we are taking our dedicated freight corridor in Vadodara city. So there are existing tracks, we have to cross it. So bottom will be existing track, top will be dedicated track. So that kind of structures we term it as rail flyover. Then footover bridge, normally knows it is an alternate to pedestrian subways. Wherever there is a land restriction for underground structures, we used to go with the footover bridge. So these are the normal classification of railway structures. This can be referred in Indian Road Congress, there is separate body, RDSO, which is having a specified standards for railway structures. So these kind of classifications we can refer from IRS Concrete Bridge Code. There also they are giving all these terminologies and classifications. Then I will go to the viaduct detail. Now from the classification, I have picked one structure for our case study where we used this full span launching technology. So this is the structure general arrangement, which is nothing but a plan. If you see like a plan, it will be like a small snake-like structure. But if you see it in actual, it is around 2.76 kilometers. So the details of the structure is, it is having 85 spans of 32 meters. Span is nothing but one pier to pier. In our academic or in our normal terminology in reference to building, we used to call it as column to column. So one column to other column, it is around 32 meter. Due to scale constraint in my slide, this 32 meter is looking only this much. But in physical, if you see 32 meter, it will be around more than 10 story building in terms of length wise. So 85 numbers of 32 meter span plus two numbers of 19.8 meter span. So basically this 19.8 meter span we have proposed at this road crossing because of the constraint of the column location here. And then total length of the bridge is 2.76 kilometer. Maximum height of the bridge is 23.77 meter. 23.77 meter we can physically imagine like more than 7 story building from the ground level to the top of the railway. So our almost all 32.5 ton axle load with 100 kmph speed and the train length is around 1.5 kilometer, it will run at an elevation of 7th story, more than 7th story building from ground level. You can see how huge the structure it will be, but in schematic and the drawing presentation it looks like this nest. This structure is basically comes with a curve also. There are restriction as per the railway standard, curve restriction with 700 meters. So based on the land availability, we are proposed to this kind of alignment, which comes, the starting point will be like a hilly area, then it will run through the thickly populated area. That's why we need the bridge of this much length. I can show to the next slide with the Google map. So you can see here, this is a hilly area, complete part of hilly area. The highlighted portion is the bridge length. It is of 2.6 kilometer. From there, again, it will be connecting to the other part of our alignment to the Dadri location. This side, it will be a Rivari location. So from this point to this point is our structure location where we implemented this full span launching. This will be hilly area, and this will be, if you see, it is completely a populated area where many buildings are there. So we cannot take our railway structure at the ground level. That's why we are getting this much length of bridge. If you see my presentation, there is one white patch like this. It's nothing but this is a casting yard. We have planned for this precast segment. So all our 32 meter peer-to-peer, whatever the superstructure comes, that we use to cast it over here, and then we use to erect from this point to this point up to here. Then we are continue to erect for other structures also where we are having the similar span, so that our construction time, it will have a huge reduction and more cost saving. I'll go to my next slide. Since I'm using some structure terminology called substructure, superstructure, so I want to give the brief idea of structural component terminology. When we compare with the buildings that where we used to study during academics, mostly building analysis, which is simple method to understand the concept. When it comes to the field, we have to use this knowledge, academic knowledge, for actual engineering application orientation. That time we have to come across many engineering terminologies. To get that link, I'm giving this brief idea. When it comes to buildings, we used to call it as foundation, and then substructure, and then slab. The same terminology when it comes to bridge structure, we used to call it as foundation, which will be below ground level, and then above ground level is substructure. Above ground level up to the bearing point where the slab is there, which will take the live load, that we used to call it as a superstructure. So the load from train, live load in the sense train, from live load, the load will be transferred to the slab. Here, instead of slab, we are having a box girder. There are the n number of types of girders, superstructures are there. This is one type of superstructure. We used to call it as box girder. Since we are having a 32 meters of span length, we used to adapt this kind of huge superstructure to cater the heavy axle load from running train. This superstructure will transfer the load to the bearing. From bearing, substructure will take. That is nothing but a cap and column. It will take the load and it will transfer to the foundation based on the geographical parameters and constraints. There are different types of foundation we use to adapt in bridge structures. Generally, they will go with the open foundation, but in this case of viaduct, based on the geotechnical parameter and the load constraint, we are adapting pile foundation. In case wherever the perennial rivers are there we are adapting well foundation also. In olden days, if you see the railway structures, because of conventional practice and because of heavy load and more conservation in safety, our most of the railway structures will be adapted with well foundation only. But if we look it into a construction point of view, the time taking for construction, that is basically execution and material consumption, it will be very huge in terms of well foundation. Now we developed with the pile foundation. So this pile foundation is and drastically reduce the in this viaduct, box girder, then pier cap, since one will be connected through this pier cap, then pier pile cap. Pile cap will be slab like structure which will connected with a group of pile foundation. Then from pile cap, the load will be transferred to the pile foundation to the ground. I'll go to the next slide. So now we have seen the brief of structural component. I will come to the brief of superstructure component. Specifically, since we are discussing about the railway structure, when compared to buildings, what are the superstructure components that differ, which is having a permanent load impact That's why I have given the details of superstructure. This we might have seen when we are just walking or walking in the platform, or when we are the main component will be the railway track based over a box girder. There is a specific path called footpath that the gangmen to walk, and then handrails for protection. So all these together will impose a load as a permanent load, which has to be considered in the designing point of view for the substructure. I have given two specific sections. One is end section box girder, and then mid section box girder. If you see these, this will be more thickened. The end section will be more thickened, and the mid section will have more opening. This is nothing but on design point of view, we made it as economical section. That's why we have adapted two sections. These details I will give it in a brief in the next slide with the drawing, so that it will be more easy to understand. This is just a 3D schematic sketch which will show that component. I will go to my next slide. This is the superstructure drawing. In terms of, we used to call it as a sketch, but when it comes to engineering application, the terminology will be changing to drawing. Whatever we have seen in 3D, that is for better understanding for discussion purpose, I have made it. When the people comes from academic to the engineering application orientation, basically for civil engineers, they need to understand that engineering is major part, but the convey of engineering application, it will be mainly through the drawing. So why I'm highlighting this drawing point is, I have seen many engineers, even I also got struggled when I started my career. So struggle in the sense, during academic we'll have many subjects like hydraulics, strength of material, structural analysis, many structures, many subjects. One or two subjects will be related to drawing, but the importance of drawing, it will come to know when we are in a exact field application. The language of civil engineers to communicate our engineering analysis and design will be only through the drawing. So my personal suggestion to faculty members, so that they will be well aware how to work out to the field execution, which will be come as a actual physical structure. So these communication will be through the structural drawing only. That's why I have added this one slide. So it's my personal interest and request for the faculty members to give the importance of structural drawing, how to prepare the drawing and how to read the drawing while planet deck, planet soffit and section AA. This is nothing but a sectional
Excuse
elevation.
Me, sir.
Yes.
Sir, we are getting a little disturbance, sir. I think we have some network issues.
Okay. Is it clear now?
No, sir. Your voice is breaking, sir.
Okay. Can I stop my video so that the audio it will be a little bit clear?
Yes, sir. You can try for that, sir.
Yeah. My voice is audible now. Is it clear now?
Yes, sir. It is clear now, sir.
Fine. I can go. Shall I continue my presentation?
Yes, sure, sir.
Okay. Thank you. So if you see the drawing, there is a basically when we are studying the engineering drawing, it will be like a plan, elevation, and then section, which will be viewed like isometric view. So this box girder, if you read it as an engineering drawing, it will be this way only. So if you see the plan at deck level, this will be plan at this level. Plan at soffit is plan at this level, cut section, which shows the web thickness. This is the web thickness, and two web thicknesses, this and this one will be the slab connected with the web. So, as I said in my previous slide, at the support point, this is the location where it will be seated over the pier cap, and this will be the center of the span. If you see the thickness of the web, this will be higher at this location, and it then goes to the mid span, this will be lesser. Why this kind of change in thickness is, if it's nothing but a basic concept of shear force and bending moment. When it comes to the support location, it will have a higher shear. So to take care of higher shear, we used to adapt higher thickness. When it comes to the center of the span, we will have a higher bending moment. For higher bending moment, it will be catered through the section modulus. So there, our thickness will not play a major role. Overall section, as a section modulus, it will place, that is M by Z compass, M by Z component. If we increase the Z component, then we can reduce the stress at the center span. That's why to optimize and to make economical section, we are reducing the sectional thickness, web thickness at this location, and we will get a higher depth. With the higher depth, we will get the higher section modulus. There we can optimize the overall section. So in elevation, the same, if I cut this location, that is in section, if I cut this location, the elevation will be looks like. This is the end diaphragm point where we need the solid section, the support to cater higher shear force, and to give some pre-stressing provision, we need this diaphragm. And at the center point, it will be a hollow. It will be interconnected with the two diaphragms, that is the deviators for future pre-stressing. This is as per the railway standard, we need to keep a provision for future pre-stressing. I'll go to my next slide. The design philosophy, the design concepts, what we adapted, what we used to adapt in a railway design. So design consideration, basically this box cutter designed as a pre-stressed concrete element in the longitudinal direction. It is simple, conventional and conservative method, like our simply supported beam. How we used to analyze a simply supported beam, same, but this, if you see the structure, it will be very huge. But if it goes to the analysis and design point of view, it will be similar to our academic, what we are learning from the academy. So the basic concepts are same. Only when it comes to engineering application, we have to fine tune it for the actual structural component. So the box cutter will be designed, analyzed as a beam, simply supported beam in longitudinal direction. Then it will be designed as a RCC member in transverse direction. Whatever this top slab is there, this slab will be analyzed as a RCC member. Like from here, this will be the cantilever. So for this cantilever, this slab will be analyzed. This will be analyzed for this sagging moment. Whichever is critical for that, we have to provide this thickness and reinforcement. So concept wise, only our academic second year or third year subject, shear force and bending moment, it will play a huge role to understand the structural behavior and analysis part. That's why whatever we are learning in our academics, it will be more important. That is the basic. If you are very clear with our basic, then how much will be the complex structure, we can easily analyze it and make it a, we can provide the conservative solution. The third point is analysis and design are carried out for various combinations and application loads as per Indian Railways and employer requirement. Employer requirement is nothing but a specific owner's requirement, the dedicated freight corridor requirement. And other than that, there is a standard, like our Indian Bureau of Indian Standard Code, there is a specific code for Indian Railways that we used to term it as Indian Railway Standard. So basically based on the load categories and load combinations, which is prescribed in this standard, we used to consider for our analysis and design purpose. Then stress check are done for the girders under the critical load combination as per the IRS bridge rule. And there is other standard called IRS concrete bridge code. It is similar to our IS456 and IS875. So the design philosophy, it will be similar, and it will be, if we interpret with our building design, it will be almost all similar. Only the major part variation is analysis. Since the structural behavior and force flow is different from building, we have to make a specific analysis using now available analyzing tools like MIDAS, STATRO, that can be used for a complex analysis purpose. So the design standards now, whatever I have given the comparison of IS 456 and the IS 875, these are the terminologies and codal numbers we use to refer during our academic education point of view. But when my voice is audible, sir, I think I'm getting some notification. I think it is clear. I will let me proceed my presentation. So to get more idea and easy interpretation on a structural application orientation, I'm giving the comparison for the codal reference. The basic code will start from loading. During analysis, we used to refer the code for loading. What are the loads to be considered and what are the standard loads it will be and what is the percentage of factor of safety we have to consider, load factors. So that will be deals in loading. And then RCC specification, this is particularly for material specification and workmanship specification and whatever the tolerances we have to consider. So this will be specified in RCC specification. And if it comes to pre-stressing, nowadays in buildings and major infrastructures, we started implementing this pre-stressing technology. So now our code has a separate specification like a pre-stressing specification, then specification for substructure and foundation. Basically, when we are dealing with the buildings, there is no separate code for substructure and foundation. But when it comes to infrastructure, and particularly construction point of view and more safety point of view, there is substructure and foundation code specified to follow that guideline. Then seismic guidelines. Nowadays, there are major development in seismic guidelines to make our structure more stable and more economic. Then steel, if our material changes from RCC to PSC, then alternate we are using steel. So steel structures will have a separate specification. Then structural manual is nothing but the execution manual. So each and every category of structures, like a building, we are using NBC. Similar way for roads and railways, there are different structural manuals. This bearings is the terminology we use to consider only in infrastructures, particularly in bridges, not in buildings. So this will be new to the engineers who are joining from after completion of their degree and in engineering firms. If particularly in bridges, it will be very new to them. So I think in specialization like MTech and ME, they are having this separate subject for bridge engineering. There we are specifying and they're having a topic on this. Now I will give the specific numbers. What are the codes we used for railway sectors? For loading, we used to refer IRS bridge rule. For RCC and PSC, there is a concrete bridge code. And for substructure and foundation, there is a railway standard called bridge substructure and foundation code. And seismic guidelines, there is a separate seismic code and RDSO guidelines also. RDSO is nothing but railway design research and design segment organization for specifically for railways. Then steel structure, that is steel bridge code. Then like our building manual, there is IRS bridge manual, which is specifying many construction tolerances and construction limitations. So we have to consider for that. When it comes to bearing, still we are following in railways the UIC code. It is nothing but a French code, Union International Code for bearings. This is specific number for bearing. There are many numbers to be specified for loading and other categories like this in that French code. So when it comes to buildings, this is in comparison with the academic and the current engineering application orientation, that is the field. So in railway segment, we are referring these codes. This we can interpret with our academic reference code is IS 875. How we are referring IS 875 for dead load, superimposed load, and live load. Similar way, in railway sectors, we used to refer this bridge rule. Like IS 456 for specification of RCC, we used to refer this concrete bridge code. It will be almost all similar, only there are few conservation parameters that will be differs from IS 456 to particularly for railway structures. then IS 1343 for PSC, IS 456 and 2911 for we used to refer for building. This 2911 is particularly for pile foundation. Here there is a separate code for this substructure. Then 1893 seismic, there is similar way we are having a seismic guidelines. Then IS 800 for building steel structures, here we are having a railway steel code. The National Building Code as a manual, we are having a separate bridge manual for railway structures. Mostly bearing may not be involved in buildings, that's why I kept it as not applicable. When it comes to road structure, similar way like a railway, they are having Indian Road Congress and they are having specific number for the codes. For loading IRC 6, for specification IRC 112, then for substructure they are having IRC 78, for seismic guidelines both in loading code itself they are combined in IRC 6, then steel structures IRC 24, and for composite like a steel girder over deck slab, if you see ROBs, they used to go with a steel girder over that, there is a concrete deck slab. So there we have to use IRC 24 and IRC 22. Then for a manual, they are adding most or more Ministry of Road or Surface Transport manual. When it comes to bearing, they are adding Indian Road Congress bearing codes 83, which is having a different parts, part 1, part 2, part 3 and part 4. This is different parts for different types of bearing, like elastomeric bearing, and for pin and pot bearing, that is metallic bearing, and for spherical and cylindrical bearing, there are different parts. So these are the brief comparison, and to get academic people to compare whatever they are referring the code with the infrastructure, particularly road bridges and railway bridges, what are similar codes we are referring, and we are adapting the standards for that comparison. So I will go to my next slide. This is design philosophy, in the sense, since it is a huge box type structure, if you go with RCC, we cannot limit our depth. For 32 meter, if you are going with RCC, it may request the depth of 5 meter or 6 meter. To restrict the depth, we are adapting pre-stressing technique. With the pre-stressing technique, we, for a huge load of 32.5 ton, we are limiting the depth with 3 meters. And these are the pre-stressing strands, which is similar other than our normal reinforcement, normal HYSC bars, that will be like a skin reinforcement. So to cater the pre-stressing force, we are providing this strand. Since this box girder is a pre-tension, it will be like a strands only will be there. When it comes to post-tension, it will be like a cables. So these strands at location of the starting point, it will be debonded. Basically, I will show the stress diagram, then it will be easy to understand why this debonding is required. So this is the stress diagram, which is the design output. If you see the stress diagram, as per the code, there is a limitation. Our concrete stress should be limited. We are adapting M50 grade. For M50 grade, we have to limit M55 grade. We have to limit the concrete grade to 0.5 FCK. So it will be around 22. When it comes to tension, we have to limit to zero tension. So that's why the bottom limit is zero. So there are different in the cross sections at top and bottom. So these are the top stresses which has been limited with the within the compressive stress, and the bottom stresses within limited within zero tension. Why top it will be a compression, bottom it will be tension? If we look into our beam design, when it is bending, top will be a compression, bottom will be tension. Same it will be applicable to our huge railway box girders also. That's why in the initial I used the terminology is basic beam, simply supported beam, similar way only. Analysis, the basic will be remain same. So these are the limitation, and after the design we optimize the section with this limitation. When it comes to this structure, PSC structure, in beam design we will limit only one point for bending stress and shear force and bending moment for the bending stress. When it comes to exact field orient field application, there are different stages. That is during pre-stressing, and then during launching, and then during service condition. So service condition will be the ultimate point, but before it comes to play for the service condition, it is having a other load implication also. That is stress with LG. When it is lifted through launching girder, it has to check whether the structure will be within the stress limit or not. So this stress diagram shows that during launching girder, based on the different point of loading, we have checked it and we found it, our section is work in that condition also. And then lifting of girder during transportation. Since we are using a full span launching method, these two additional stages are there. When it comes to in situ construction or pre-stressing at the pre-stressing yard itself, means only this and lifting, these two stages will be there. When it comes to FSL full span launching method, we need to check for other two construction stages also. That's why we have included these. So this debonding, I said about this debonding. When it comes to, if you see this criteria, stress diagram, we can see that the stresses, it is going this way, which is nothing but top fiber. When it comes to bottom fiber, it will go like this. It is, we can interpret this with the bending moment diagram. For a UDL, simply supported beam with the UDL, at center point it will be higher bending moment. To cater that bending moment, we are adapting the strands and we are introducing the pre-stress. If it is a post tension, we used to adapt, the cable will be like this. Similar way, since it is a pre-tension, there will be straight cables only. But to vary the pre-stressing force, we are reducing the bonding up to this point. Therefore, if you are having this many 68 cables, if you see number of cables, total number of cables is 164 numbers. Sorry, 68 is, it will be at one part. Total number will be 164. This 164 will be effective at this location. When it comes to this location, here we are, our bending moment will be very less. So the application of pre-stressing here requirement will be very less. So at this location, we are adapting the debonding. Debonding is nothing but there is a PVC or HDPE pipe which will not provide a bond between the strands to the concrete member. Therefore, whatever the pre-stressing force we are applying, it will not implement any stress to the concrete member at this location. So the pre-stressing will be limited. Pre-stressing force will be limited at this location. Where it is effectively required at the center location, it will be completely bonded. So there the pre-stressing force will be more effective. That we can interpret bending moment and the pre-stressing force application. Philosophy and the brief of our case study. Now I will go to full span launching of pre-stress segment. Full span launching method, FSLM in short terms, we used to call it as precast full span method of construction, is one of the fastest technique used in construction of bridges and viaduct. From the name itself, we can easily understand that full span launching. So one pier to other pier, that is one superstructure. In our traditional or conventional practice, what we used to do is we will provide a shuttering, and for that shuttering we will provide a trestle or staging arrangement from the ground, and we will make a formwork at the elevated level. Then we tie the reinforcement, then we will pour the concrete to cast the our concrete superstructure segment. But here what we are doing is we are completely casting the segment, complete 32 meter length and 3 meter and 3.5 meter depth at the precast location. We are casting the segment and we are parallelly executing the pile pier and pile cap. Thereby two activities will run parallelly. We will reduce the construction duration, and then we will transport that segment and we will erect it in the actual bridge location. That is called as this brief of full span launching method. Now the stages involved in this FSLM process is first part is casting yard, casting of whole span at the yard. Initially we have to prepare, we have to identify the casting yard location which is nearby to the bridge location so that transportation will be easy. So it involves casting yard preparation based on how many segments at a time we are going to prepare, that is casting yard requirement. Then rebar gauging for full span. Rebar gauging is nothing but we have to tie the reinforcement for the complete full span at the ground level. Then inner and outer shuttering for full span segment. After making the gauge to cast the concrete, we need the formwork. So it will be easy to make the formwork or shuttering at the ground level. This is the third stage. Then pre-tensioning. Before, since it is a pre-tensioned, pre-stressed component, before pouring the component, we are placing the tendons or spans, and we are applying compressive force. Then we are pouring the concrete. Then it involves curing process. So these are normal our casting of precast beams, similar to precast beams. Then the second stage is after we made complete casted segment with the pre-stressing, then we have to transport it to the stocking yard, that is shifting from casting bed to the stocking yard, from stocking yard to the bridge location. Since we are casting a huge segment, it is having a load, specific load will be around 130 ton. So 130 ton, if we imagine in terms of elephants, it will be more than 60 to 70 elephants. So that much 60 to 70 elephant weight will have only one single unit. So it involves heavy equipment, multi-axle tire mounted trolley. That heavy equipment is deployed here to shift the component from casting location to the stockyard location. And then from stockyard location to the bridge location. Then the last point is erection. After transportation from stock location to our bridge location, we have to erect it. For that, we have used a gantry crane for lifting and then launching girder. After lifting from ground level to elevated bridge level, from there, we are using launching girders for the placing of full span in final position and to erect in the succeeding spans, from first spans to the till the end of the bridge. These are the flow chart shows our FSLM process. Now I will go to why we have adapted or why it is this full span launching methodology is required, particularly in this case study where I have taken this Vizag structure is, as I said, in the geographical scenario, the structure is at part will be at hilly location and the part will be at thickly populated location. Staging from ground level to 27 meter elevated for single span and total number of 86 spans, it will take more than a year to construct the bridge. To reduce the construction period, we have taken a call to implement this full span launching method, that is shorter construction period. Then at a difficult terrain with larger pier height, make it very difficult for other conventional methods of construction with limited time. As I explained now, we have used this method. Avoid laborious process involving large number of workmen, farmers over undulated bed profile and crossing. It will be easy to deploy huge number of manpower at ground level, but when it comes to at an elevated level, it is having various safety hazards and more risk. To avoid that, we found FSLM will be more economical and safer method to implement it. That's why we use this FSLM method in Viaduct 92 structure. Viaduct 92 is number, bridge number. Now I will go to the whatever we seen it in the flow chart, it will be in a schematic or in a sketch presentation. So first will be our casting yard activity. It is having a boundary. There is a limitation for land. So this we use it to call it as ROW, right of way. This is the area where we limited our casting activities. Then there is 220 kV electrical line, it is running over there. We found this location very nearer to our bridge. In our in my third slide or fourth slide, I have shown with the Google map exactly at this nearer to the start of bridge, I shown the casting yard. This is blow up image of the casting yard location and activity. So this is the gantry track where we need to lift the full segment and move the full segment to the starting yard. We need the gantry crane. So gantry crane usually run through the track. So this is the track position. This is the gantry crane. It will be, I will show the sketch, picture also. If you see it in a plan, it will be like a, in elevation, it will be like a inverted C like that. In plan, it is two lines. So these two will be run parallelly. This will be equipped to lift the segments. So this is the casting bed where typical four segments can be casted at a time, and another two beds where two segments will be casted at a time. So we need a workspace between these two for a pre-stressing and other activities. That's why we kept these spaces empty. These are the stacking bed location. After casting here, we have to move these to this location. This is called stacking yard, stacking bed. Then this is the location of bridge where it will start. Abutment is nothing but the end of the bridge part. From there, first span, second span, and succeeding spans will start. This is longitudinal shifting track from stocking bed to move the, to transport the segment from this yard to bridge location. We laid a temporary track with a trolley. It will be easy to transport the segment from here to here. This is the rebar gauge, which is nothing but normal reinforcement gauging location. After complete gauging for one segment, we will be moving. These are the shutter location we use at the place for other accessories. So after gauging, we will shift this gauging to the precast segment location, and then we place the shuttering, outer shutter and inner shutter. Then we do the pre-stressing. So after placing the reinforcement and shuttering, we will place the pre-tensioning high tensile steel, and we do the jacking. These are the live jacking ends. These two will be the dead jacking end. This will be like a permanent jacking location, which will be fixed. Only here we deploy the live jacking to apply the pre-stressing force based on the load requirement for the segment. Since it is with the pre-tensioning, we are adapting all four and two components together as a pre-stressing. That is the advantage of pre-tensioning. If it goes for a post-tensioning, you have to do each and every segment separate. So that will be huge time and cost will be highly required. So we have adapted pre-tensioning techniques here. So after casting the segment, removing the shuttering, then it will be transferred to the start yard location to the multi-axial trolley. these are the starting beds. After starting bed, it will be transferred to the bridge location, so that from this track it will be mounted and erected over the bridge location. So typical elevation is this way. This is the gantry, what I so said, like inverted T. So this is our abutment, that is bridge pier location. So these are the box component. It will be lifted and placed for the two track at two locations. This is the method we have adapted. So that is at the casting yard. This is at the erection location. So after transporting at first span, it will be erected to the gantry, and then for the succeeding span, we are deploying tire transporters here over. So each and every segments will be placed over to the first, and then gantry will be moved to the second one. So first two spans will be used for placing the segments from the stocking yard. This is the launching girder. So if you see the gantry, it is having a capacity of 180 tons. Since our segments are 130 ton weight, we need to have more than that, twice more than that. So the capacity of the gantry is 180 ton. Launching girder used for the erection of succeeding span. So this way, all 86 spans we have erected using this full span launching method. This is the schematic and animated sketch which shows the execution method. Now I will go to the realistic pictures which shows the gauge and shuttering and how huge the structure will be and the transporter details. So this is the yard which I have shown it in the schematic sketch with the rebar gauge location and shuttering location. This is the aerial view. These are the segmental 1, 2, 3, 4 segmental location where the gauges, reinforcement gauge is prepared here, and then it will be placed over here. Then the outer shuttering will be placed. Then this is the placing of reinforcement gauge. Then inner shuttering. This is assembling of inner shuttering. After placing the reinforcement gauge, this inner shuttering will be placed at inner. Then tendons will be placed. That is, fans will be placed in the web and bottom flap. These are the fans. And this is the dead end at two locations, and this is the live end where we place the jack to apply the pre-stressing force. And this is the pre-stressing application at the live end. These are the photographs where I have taken from Eastern dedicated freight corridor. There also they have implemented this, that is in Sohn Bridge at Mughal Saral. This is done by Tata Construction. So this is concrete and curing, and then it will be moved to the stocking bed. If you see the full segment, the size of the segment, it will be around 3.6 meter, 3 to 3.5 meter. If you see the height, a person height will be around 1.5 meter, but the segment height will be 3 times more than that. The transportation of these segments with a huge weight, it will be very difficult. It cannot be done through our normal crane. So we have deployed a special equipment like a trolley, shifting trolleys. The shifting trolley, it is having some special arrangement. It's nothing but if you see this location, this is our in a casting bed. That in this location the segments will be this way. So using the crane we can shift this as vertically. We cannot rotate the segment. So parallel to the segment, trolleys will be placed over here. To transport this to this location, we have to make the trolley to move perpendicularly. So these trolleys having a special feature to rotate with 90 degrees. So during placing, our trolleys will be placed this way. When it is used to transport to the stockyard, this will be rotate to the 90 degrees. So trolleys will run this way. That is this. This is nothing but side shifting from casting bed to the stacking bed, from stacking bed to the longitudinal track. And with the higher span launching 400 metric ton, and the power will be this much. These are mechanical features. The axles of this trolley is 12 axles. Number of speed change will be 5. It will be completely a remote controlled trolley only. Steering track will be hydraulic, and driving direction will be in two directions, that is front and back, and it can be rotated to 90 degrees. That is the sophisticated or costly equipment we deployed for this full span launching. Similar way, our gantry crane and launching girder. This also a costly equipment we also used for this full span launching. The capacity we used for launching is 360 ton. Single gantry is 180. We used two launching gantry. It is in that two inverted C shape. This is single launching gantry with the 360 ton for the succeeding span erection. So minimum operating radius is 700 meters. Our in my initial plan, the curvature of the bridge is limited to 700 meters. Similar way, launching girder also operating radius is limited with 700 meters. So it has helped us to erect easily in the bridge location. This is the portal gantry where I said that 180 ton. So span of the portal gantry is 25 meter for erecting two tracks. Then the height of gantry is 35 meter maximum. It can be adjustable based on the height requirement. Number of portal gantry two we used per gantry capacity is 180 ton. So this is the actual executed location. This is also taken from Eastern Corridor. This is the first span they were placed at abutment location. From then it has placed launching girder is used to erect for the succeeding span. This is the second span. Then it comes to parallelly they are erecting for both the tracks. So from the starting point it has started erecting to the succeeding. So similar way the other projects where this full span launching method adapted, I have taken some collected some data and I am included in my presentation for better understanding. In Saudi Arabia Riyadh Metro, they have implemented this full span launching method, and in Korea, basically these metros will be in thickly populated cities. So casting the superstructure at elevated location and for n number of, that is around 45 kilometers or 20 kilometers, it is not possible to go with each span with the staging. So they are using this full span launching method. Similarly, in Korea, for a highway bridge which is constructed over a sea, they have used this full span launching. Before going into this international project, just I will give the brief of how much saving when we are going with the full span launching is. Only in construction time point of view, I can say that if you go with the normal single span erection, every span requires minimum 1 month for executing or constructing this segment. But when we are going with this full span launching method, per span cycle is only 7 days. So the total period, it will be reduced from years to months, per span from month to week. So within a week, our effective construction period is reduced from month to week. Overall bridge construction from year to month. That's what the most economical point on overall cost efficiency. Full span launching will be more economic even when compared with the our normal conventional method. Even though we are deploying with highly equipped and sophisticated costly gantry cranes, launching girders and multi-axle trolleys. So this is Riyadh Metro corridor. They are having different corridor, line 4 and 6. It is viaduct portion. So all this viaduct portion, they have used this full span launching method, these two corridors. So this is the launching girder they have adapted in Riyadh Metro. It is having a radius limitation of 1250 meters, but in our DFCC we have used radius limitation of 700 meters. The maximum length of the launching is 36 meters. It is having a lifting capacity of 460. This is the gantry crane for lifting the superstructure from the stockyard and transporting location to the first span. This is the cross section of the box cutter. So the height of the box cutter used in Riyadh Metro is 2.35. It is catering two metro tracks. Since the track metro is lesser load, they have adapted single box cutter for the two tracks with a lesser depth. This is the typical section height of the track is 2.35 meters. Since they have adapted with the full span launching, here also pre-stressing technique is a pre-tension girder they have adapted with varying spans. Because of city constraint and crossroad constraints, their spans are varying from 28 meter, 32 meter, and 36 meter. Then, since Riyadh Metro is involved in rural area, sorry, urban area, the stockyard will be little bit getting more area to stock is difficulty. So what they did is they plan to stock after casting in one above the other. So after erecting this, they started casting stocking over the erected girders itself, so that they can avoid the stocking location at the ground. Again, this needs higher gantry to place this girders to one over above. And this is the launching girder with a radius, with operating radius of 1200 meter. Wherever the curvature comes, this is already erected from this pier to this pier. They are rotating the launching girder with a different radius. Then that Incheon Bridge in Korea, under C construction, they have adapted this full span launching method. It is having a special span of cable stayed bridge where they need more clearance for ship movement. So this will be the special and obligatory span they have adapted with cable stayed. From this obligatory span, for more than a kilometer, we need a viaduct portion, that is approach bridge, where we are gone up with the normal pre-stress box girders. This is erected using full span launching. Similar way of our casting yard. This is the pictures of Incheon Bridge casting yard location. This is the inner mold and outer mold and the hold up device for molding. These are mostly they are equipped with automatic machine control. This is the thrust bed, that is pre-stressing end, dead end and live end. This will be the live end and this will be the dead end. So similar our schematic of this railway casting yard. This is the casting yard and a full span bed location with the pictures. This is the casting yard with the rebar gauging and pre-stressing. This is in sketch. These are in pictures. This is rebar gauge fixing and this is pre-tensioning. After pre-tensioning, it will be moved to the bridge location for the erection purpose. These are the specific dimensions where this gauge fixing was there, and this is the yard location, and this is the pre-tensioning. So after gauge fixing, after making the shuttering, it will be moved here. After doing pre-stressing, then it will be moved to the stockyard location, then it will be moved to the erection point. So this is under the launching of full span launching. For lifting and erecting, we are placed these trolleys with a capacity of 600 ton. This is not a railway bridge, this is highway bridge. Basically, nowadays in highways, they are sorry, they are using this sophisticated and hi-fi technologies, because the rail road projects are many nowadays in infrastructure development. Since railway project development is lesser, nowadays they have started using in railways also. This is the end of my presentation. So now I left for questionnaire session. Sir.
Thank you so much, sir, for this wonderful session. I hope this presentation was very much useful for the upcoming bridge engineers. So next we would like to have a few more minutes of you for the questionnaire session, sir.
Sure.
Before going to the questionnaire session, there is a small intimation to all the participants. Feedback link will only be shared in the YouTube chat box. I repeat, feedback link will only be shared in YouTube chat box. So please do not leave the room until the end of the session. We will be online for more 20 to 25 minutes after the session. If you have any problem or if you face any problem with the feedback link while submitting it, you can mail us to the coordinators. Thank you. So now I'll carry on with the questions, sir.
Yeah.
We have few questions from Principal Sir GDEC. How consistency of bridge structure is carried out during its life cycle?
Can you repeat? I didn't get.
How consistency of bridge structure is carried out during its life cycle?
Since we are actually while designing itself, we will consider this durability criteria. Basically, railway bridges and road bridges are planned for lifespan of 100 years. So, in a durability point of view, all these parameters are specified in the code. So, all codal parameters which we are following, so the lifespan will be ensured there. Consistency of bridge structure is basically we are adapting the concrete structures. So, concrete structures, it won't have major maintenance. Only the components which I mentioned as a bearing, it needs the frequent maintenance and it needs the frequent replacement. So particularly railways are subjected to high dynamic loading. So every 15 years in the bridge manual, they have mentioned the frequency of period to check, inspect and replace the bearing based on the damages. So there will be exposed to the damages. So that way we are monitoring the structural durability and maintenance.
Sir, thank you, sir. The second question is, what precautions are being taken to avoid settlement and scouring of columns and piers of a railway bridge?
It's a good question. Actually, we are following this codal standard. So during our foundation design, based on the whatever the soil parameter, that is geotechnical investigation report we are getting. So based on that, we used to do analyze the safe bearing capacity. If it is a found open foundation, if it is a pile foundation, we used to work out the pile capacity both in vertical and lateral. So during vertical capacity workout, there is a limitation of the settlement. If it is an open foundation, there is a limit of 25 mm settlement for the live load. Why it is particularly for live load is during construction of dead load itself, it will undergo the settlement for dead permanent loads. So under live load, which is having a frequent load application, during that time, it should go only to the 25 mm settlement. Since our railway structures are simply supported, this differential settlement, it won't have any impact. Major impact of this differential settlement, it will be in monolithic structures. So the differential settlement will not take major part in simply supported structures. So that will be taken care during our foundation report. After constructing this pile or open foundation, we are ensuring the settlement for the actual load with the 2.5 times load factor, like ultimate load, we are doing the testing. So there are codal specifications that for this many pile foundation, we have to do this many number of tests. So each and every bridge, we need minimum 2 vertical pile load tests and minimum 2 lateral pile load tests as per the contract specification and codal requirement. So that we are following and we are ensuring whether it is having maximum settlement or within the settlement is reached and we are arriving the capacity or not. So that's why we are ensuring the settlement requirement. I hope I have clarified it.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. We have a next question. From structural point of view, what specific cares are required to address during construction of bridge on curvatures?
Generally, we cannot avoid the curvature because based on our land constraint and we cannot follow a straight path itself. So it has few locations we have to go with the curvature. In curvature, when compared to our normal straight conventional locations, curvature may have on a structural point of view, it will have a topple. Topple is nothing but couple. So at one location, it will have a rotating effect. So stability we have to check during in the curvature location before we are doing for other analysis other than normal shear force and bending moment analysis. First, we have to check the stability that the inner curvature portion will have a higher load than the lesser load. Because of the curvature, it will start to topple. So curvature effect, stability, we have to consider. After stability point, during analysis, we have to take additional curvature force where code specifies the specific formula to consider the curvature force with a specific speed and specific load. So we are considering that curvature force during our analysis. Basic on analysis, we have to take additional load due to curvature. Second thing, on stability point of view, we have to check the stability of structure in the curvature. This is two during technical design stage. When it comes to execution stage, we have to keep proper safety measures during erecting the curvature span. That is, load will be different. At that time, we have to check unit by unit, not unit by unit in the sense when we are erecting the span, meter by meter, when we are erecting, we have to check it whether it is placed in a proper position or not. Or else the launching girder, it will have a topple. So that way we are ensuring the construction safety.
Okay, sir. Sir, we are unable to see your video. Can you please switch it on, sir?
Yeah, sorry. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. And we have the next question from Aisha Sheikh. What should be the actual wind speed to design the bridge?
Actual wind speed, we may not say it will be applicable to every location. So it will be based on topographical location, it will be varying. There is a specific code IS 875 part 3. It is having a zone wide wind speed and wind pressure to be considered. And there are three factors like our terrain factor and the height factor. Different factors are there that is specified in the code IS 875. So we can refer IS 875 for a different wind speed at different zone. In our this dedicated freight corridor in Rajasthan and Gujarat, we are taking a wind speed of around 47 meter per second. Sorry, kilometer per hour.
Thank you, sir. We have another question from Dr. Sriramulu. What is the life period of precast structures?
Sir, life period in the sense we are considering the durability lifespan of structure is 100 years, sir. Based on that durability parameter, we are fixing as per the codal requirement.
Thank you, sir. And we have one last question. Yes. At which magnitude these PFS are resistant to seismic action? Recently failures happen on PFS flyover and why?
I didn't get you. Can you repeat again, please?
At which magnitude these PFS are resistant to seismic action while they had recent failures happened on PFS flyover and why?
Okay. I will explain about what is the seismic parameter we are considering. This PFS flyover, I am not sure what is the PFS flyover. I will brief the seismic consideration what we are doing for our structures. There are two things. One is detailed analysis, the other one is conventional analysis of seismic part. So conventional analysis, basically that depends upon the zone. Wherever the zone is limited to 3 and 4, there we can go with a conventional practice which may not require the detailed seismic analysis. Detailed seismic analysis means the model analysis, and we have to model the structure, and we have to give the time history spectrum, and we have to apply the acceleration, and we have to analyze the different modes of deflection of the structure during seismic, then we have to identify the criticality of deflection. From then we have to fix the structural components, either reinforcement ductility or reinforcement ductility or our structural concrete grade and size. When it goes to conventional method, there are codes specify the standard formula and the coefficient to consider this dynamic effect of seismic based on the location and based on the structure stiffness. We have to adapt that coefficient. From the coefficient, we have to increase the load on the structure. With the increased load, we have to analyze the structure, whether the serviceability criteria like deflection and stresses are within the limit or not. And ultimately, during seismic, our structure should be, it can undergo crack, but it should not completely collapse. That's why we can make the limit state designs. Now performing the structure will be economy and safe during the seismic period, seismic and wind period. So all these codal parameters we are considering. Additionally, on more safety point of view, we are detailing the reinforcement by considering the ductility point of view. So wherever that point of hinge, it will develop based on the integral of the structure. We have to identify that location and we have to provide additional care in the detailing point and additional reinforcement for that. That way we are ensuring the seismic safety in the structure. When it comes to cable state structure or other integral structures, there this seismic will have more major impact. And we have to do modal analysis, which will be subjected to different modes and different deflections.
Thank you, sir. And sorry, sir, we have one last question.
Sure, sir.
From Firoz. How can we decide minimum number of piers needed to safely transfer dynamic loads into the ground?
Can you come back? I didn't get it.
How can we decide minimum number of piers needed to safely transfer dynamic loads into the ground?
Okay. First, I will explain how we are considering the dynamic, particularly in railway structures. Since I explained our dedicated freight corridors are with a 32.5 axial load and the speed will be 100 kmps, so we can think a person standing nearby the station and when the train is running with 100 kmps for 1.5 kilometers, it will be like a boom. So our normal train itself, we will have a major vibration. So what Indian Railways, they are having a separate research body, that is RDSO. They have converted this dynamic effect into an impact factor, that is coefficient of dynamic augment. So our normal loading 32.5 tonners, it will be increased with a dynamic factor that will be on the conservative side. So our dynamic consideration will be considered with the increased live load. That will be considered during the superstructure. When it comes to substructure, to the foundation, what code specifies is up to the pier cap, there will be a dynamic impact. When it comes to the structure foundation, that vibration, it will get reduced, which means basically it will get dispersed. So on conservation point of view, we can consider the same dynamic coefficient to increase or to enhance the normal load, and we can consider that increased load for our design point of view. So that this dynamic impact will be considered.
Thank you, sir. Now we have finished our question session.
Okay.
I hope sir has given all the answers to the questions. And now before I conclude my part, I would like to thank my college management, principal sir and HOD sir for giving me this wonderful opportunity to host this event. I also thank all the resource persons for 5 days of this FDP program for enlightening us with their outstanding technical presentations. Last but not the least, I sincerely thank all the participants for your time and patience in making this FDP a grand success. So now that's all from my side. This is Zahir Alam Khan signing off, and I would like to hand over the session to my colleague Muhammad Ali for vote of thanks.
Thanks for the wonderful session. I hope today's session was informative and knowledgeable.
We look forward for more sessions with you, sir. So finally, vote of thanks. Good afternoon, all. I feel privileged on this occasion to deliver my vote of thanks for the fifth day of FDP on emerging trends in civil engineering. Firstly, I would like to convey our sincere thanks to today's resource person, Sri V. Govindam Garu. I would like to convey my special thanks to our correspondent, Madam V.K. Padma Uttama Garu, Managing Director, Sri G. Raghunath Reddy Garu, Director, Madam Srimati V.K. Srivani Garu, and our beloved Principal, Sir Dr. P. Bhaskar Patel, for their motivation, support, and encouragement. I would like to heartfelt thanks to my fellow faculty members who have been supporting me in all tasks for organizing this FDP. Last but not least, I thank all the participants throughout the country and across the globe for your time and patience in making fifth day of FDP a grand success. We wish your presence here. Now we are closing the session on count 5. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Thank you all.